reflection of my own career and those points in my career that were changing points and the role of mentoring in how that worked. And from that, I have come up with some thoughts about how we mentor other people in higher education. So this is a personal reflection. And you'll know more about me when I'm done than maybe you care to know. But I did use my own career as an example of mentoring. Okay, so let's move along here. I think mentoring is a three-part process. And the three parts, I think, are finding the path. You know, you sort of, when you're in school, you're studying some topic and everything, but where do you go next? What do you do? How do you find a job? What kinds of things do you investigate and explore? You have to find some path for you that's going to work for you. But I also think it involves figuring out how to make a contribution to this world that we live in. You know, other than just my personal feeling here, other than just making a lot of money in life, I think it's important that we make some sort of contribution. And the third part of this image is, I think it involves, the whole process involves continually learning, lifelong learning. We don't stop learning when we graduate from school. We don't stop learning when we finish taking a class. We're continually learning all the time. So I'm going to base this talk on these three parts and point out how they worked in my career and how we might mentor others in their lives. Okay. First part, finding your way. And there's many people have written about this. Many people, many famous people have written about this. How you find your way, how do you figure out what you want to do. And I like this quote here. Follow your dreams. Don't be afraid of the space between. Don't be afraid of the space between your dreams and reality. If you can dream it, you can make it so. Don't be afraid of that space. Dream. What would you like to do? What would give you joy and pleasure? And this is next one. Follow your bliss. This is a famous statement by Joseph Campbell. He's written a lot. And on following your heart about doing something. He said, it is a matter of identifying that pursuit which you are truly passionate about and attempting to give yourself absolutely to it. In so doing, you will find your fullest potential and serve your community. Those of you, they made a copy of this PowerPoint. We made a copy of this PowerPoint. So they don't have to write down everything. Okay, whatever. Right. This is a famous book in our field of adult education. Miles Horton and Paulo Freire. And the name of the book is "We Make the Road by Walking." We make the road by walking. We make our way in the world by walking, by moving along. And they have a conversation in this book. And one thing is, Miles Horton says, there are dreams. The situation is there. You start with this and you let it grow. You know your goal. It will build its own structure and take its own form. So as you move towards a dream or some goal in life, the pathway makes itself. We make the road by walking. And I like this quote from the book from Freire. No one is born fully formed. It is through self-experience in the world that we become what we are. So think about that for a minute. You know, when you're born, you're not already somebody in particular. You know, you're the son or daughter of your mother and father, a member of your family, a member of this country, and whatever. But you really have to have experience to become what you are in the world. You're not fully formed when you're born. So this is, we make the road by walking is the idea that you become who you are by moving ahead. Okay, now I'm going to talk a little bit about my journey, the road I was on, and use it as an example for things. I got a bachelor's degree in English literature, okay, in college. This is in the 60s, 1960s, before most of you were born in the year. In the 1960s, mid-1960s, I went to college. And I didn't think about, you know, do I want to be a business person? Do I want to be a chemist? Do I want to be this, that, and I like literature, so I'm going to major in English literature. So I didn't think about what kind of job I was going to get or anything like that. But a bachelor's degree in English literature. And I went to a liberal arts college. They did not even have a business department or an education department. It was all liberal arts, like English, history, sociology, biology, those kinds of things. So, and at the time I was in college, these are very formative years for you also in the time that you're living now. Very formative. Civil rights movement, Martin Luther King. Remember Martin Luther King? He came and spoke to our college. Martin Luther King, very big, and civil rights movement was very big. In fact, some of us college students, we went, we marched down in the town where the college was to desegregate the barbershop. So that was the 1960s. Another movement was the women's movement. 1960s, women's movement. And at the time I was in college, I went to a talk and I met Gloria Steinem. Some of you maybe heard of Gloria Steinem. She still has a magazine. She must be 75 or so now. And so it was the civil rights movement, the women's movement, and who was president then? John F. Kennedy. And Kennedy was very much a part of this. He was very inspirational. And he says, one of his famous statements that made an impression on me then was, and maybe you've heard this, ask not what your country can do for you, ask what you can do for your country. So we have the civil rights movement, the women's movement, John F. Kennedy as president, while I'm in college, very formative years. Just as, you don't have to give it to them. I just was taught that you have made a copy you could send to them. Okay? Anyway, these were very, very exciting times. But, you know, any time's exciting. You're in an exciting time now, those of you in college and higher education. This is a big technology age, a big globalization age. So, but those were the influences on me when I was in college. So when I graduated from college, it was like, what do I do now? So what I did, considering these influences, was I joined the Peace Corps. Have some of you heard of the Peace Corps? And I think early on they may have had some volunteers in Thailand. The Peace Corps was founded by
Kennedy, John F. Kennedy, and what it was is it took people for 2 years and sent them into countries that needed some developing and, you know, some help. And so I volunteered to be in the Peace Corps, and I was sent to Afghanistan, Afghanistan, where I taught English in a boys' boarding school for 2 years in Afghanistan. Very basic living in Afghanistan at the time. But when we were in the 2 year service, you also had, you were given 6 weeks time to travel, but you had to stay in a region. So because I was in Afghanistan, I went to India, Nepal, Pakistan, Sri Lanka, Thailand, and trying to think where else I went. All around in the region. So India, because I said India. So I traveled there just while I was in the Peace Corps. So that was 2 years in Kabul, Afghanistan, teaching English in a boys' boarding school. Very poor boys from the provinces. Okay, then, so I get back from the Peace Corps, then what will I do? Then what will I do, right? So, I met somebody who was a superintendent of schools or something near me. And he thought, well, since you survived 2 years in Afghanistan, you could teach special ed. I didn't have one class in special education, not one class. But they had a need, and they thought, well, you know, here's somebody who taught in Afghanistan, and blah, blah. So I taught special education for a year, and decided it was not my cup of tea, so to speak. I didn't like it that much. I wasn't good at it. I didn't know anything about special ed. They put me in this classroom with special ed students, about 10 to 13 years old. And then I got it. Then the next year I taught seventh grade. Don't forget, I haven't had any teacher education courses. I had 2 years teaching, but I had no education courses. So I was taking a couple courses while I was doing this. And I decided, well, you know, I need to do something else here. So I went back and I got a master's degree in English education, thinking I would be an English teacher, because that's what I like, you know, English literature and stuff, and I'd be an English teacher. So I got a master's degree in English education. But as would have it, I moved to another place, state or something, and I ended up teaching adults it was called Adult Learning Center. And they hired me because I had a degree in English education, and I had taught in Afghanistan. So I taught in an adult learning center, ABE, which stands for Adult Basic Education, which is teaching adults to read. All right, GED is, in the US, that is getting your high school diploma, your high school diploma. And ESL, English as a Second Language, for those adults who were from somewhere else and needed English. So I taught those three things in this adult learning center. And I really loved teaching adults. I really loved teaching adults. I also did a little teaching in the Civil Service Training Center, which is the state, it was in New Jersey at the time, the state of New Jersey for its government employees had a training center. And I taught some classes there. And I taught an occasional freshman English class. So I was teaching in all these venues. One day, I was teaching in the Adult Learning Center, and there was a bulletin board in the Adult Learning Center. And I was looking at the bulletin board, and there was a notice about a course in adult education, a graduate master's level course in adult education. And I said, oh, there's a field called adult education. I didn't even know. There's a whole field called adult education. I already had a master's, but I said, I'm going to take that course because I want to find out what this field is about. So I took the course in adult education, and I found that this is what I love. I love adult education. See, this is my journey. You know, one thing, then I do another thing, and then I found what I really liked. So I did training center. Then I got a doctorate in adult education, and then I ended up teaching at university teaching. So you see my pathway. My pathway from, well, I like English, so I'll major in English. I wanted to do something to contribute to society, so I went into Peace Corps and taught in Afghanistan. And then I came back and I tried different things, and I found I liked teaching adults. This is where I felt at home. This is, this is the best. I love this. I didn't like special ed. Seventh grade, it's okay, but I liked teaching adults best. So then I went and got my doctorate, and then I ended up university teaching. Now, after I finished my doctorate, the first job I had was at Virginia Polytechnic and State University in Virginia, in the Adult Education Department. And I have to say, the first year teaching at the university was very, I was very ambivalent about the teaching. I was very, I felt like I was too far away from adults. You know, we have a saying in the U.S. that being in a university is like being in an ivy tower. You're in a tower separated from everybody else. And I felt like I missed the students that I taught reading and English to, those adult students. I missed them. And I'm teaching graduate students, and that's okay. But I felt really torn between the two things. And then something very powerful happened to me, which helped me in my career, and I'll tell you about that next. Okay, the first year I was teaching at the university, I went to a conference in Washington, D.C. It was a conference, I forget what it was on. I probably was presenting something. I went to this conference, and it was in Washington, D.C. And they had, one of the activities they had, did you want some? Okay. One of the activities they had was they were showing a movie that you could go see and watch it whenever you wanted. And I heard this movie was very good. It was a short movie. And it was Solzhenitsyn's Nobel Prize for Literature speech. He won the Nobel Prize for Literature for writing this book on the right, the Gulag Archipelago, when he was in a labor camp in Russia. Right? So I heard this was really good. And I went and watched this movie, this short film about his speech. And they had an actor reading the speech. And while they were reading the speech, they had these collage of pictures of, you know, like violent street demonstrations and prisons and all of this stuff. And when you watch this, there was no way you could not talk about it afterwards. So anybody who was watching it, whatever hour they're showing it, afterwards we would have a discussion about it. So the kinds of things that he said in this speech, you can read it online. It's a very powerful speech. It's called One Word of Truth. It's a very powerful speech. And what he says is, he's a writer. And he says, how can I, when there's so much war and violence and trouble in the world, how can I go sit by the riverside and write? How can I do that? That's, it's like seeming like a waste of time when there's so much suffering in the world. How can I do that? Is what he asked in the speech. And some of the quotes from his speech are as follows, that were very powerful. He says, well, violence does not and cannot flourish by itself. It is inevitably intertwined with lying. In the struggle against lies, art, and he includes all kinds of art here, visual art as well as writing. Art has always won and always will. He says, in his speech, he says, how can we have different measures for suffering in this world when they are close by you and there's an earthquake or a fire or a tsunami or something close by you? We feel more suffering than if it's on the other side of the world. And he says, but how can this be? How can this be? Human suffering is human suffering. And he says, literature, this is how he justifies being a writer in a world with so much trouble and violence. Literature is the one great heart that beats for the cares and misfortunes of our world, a living, heartfelt unity, reflecting the growing spiritual unity of mankind. So he says, literature is important in this world because of all the violence and lies. And he goes on to say a couple things. Here, one other quote I think I have for you. This is why I think, my friends, that in this hour of trial, we are capable of helping the world. We have no weapons of death. But let this not be our excuse. Let us not give in to a life of ease and security. And then this is a famous statement at the bottom. One word of truth is of more weight than all the rest of the world. And he says, violence in our world is supported by lies. Lying promotes violence. And what art can do, what literature can do, is to bring the one word of truth. So he gives a reason why. He gives a reason why he can say to himself, I can have a luxury of being a writer in this world of so much. This was very powerful for me because I was struggling with, should I be a university professor? I don't know. I think I might like to, go back and teach adults in the community. So this was very powerful for me. And that night, the same night I saw this, and it had an impact on me. That night, I was coming back from a restaurant in Washington, D.C., and I got a cab. And the cab driver says to me, this is the same night, the cab driver says to me, excuse me, but my English is not so good. And I said, where are you from? And he said, Afghanistan. Afghanistan. I said, Afghanistan? Salaam alaikum, wa alaikum assalam, blah, blah, blah. I remembered a few words. And he got all excited. He pulled off on a side street, turned off his cab, and we sat and we talked for about an hour. And he told me his story. This was in the 90s. This was when the Russians had come in and had taken over Afghanistan. And he said, He was a landowner and a lawyer in Afghanistan. And when the Russians came in, he fought in the underground, like at night, he would fight the Russians. And they found out, the Russians found out, and they arrested and killed his brother, his cousin, all these people. And he and his wife, and I think he had two kids at the time, they escaped in the middle of the night. They walked from Afghanistan through the mountains into Pakistan, into a refugee camp. And he was eventually able to come to the U.S. And when he's telling me this, he's like a 45-year-old man, very, very proud. He starts to cry. I start to cry. Very powerful story, very powerful story. And this came right after I saw this, I saw this Schultz-Schlitz and One Word of Truth thing. And this was a big turning point in my life. Because what I decided after this encounter was that I could make a contribution through my university teaching. I could make maybe a bigger contribution than if I went and sat and taught reading to somebody, because I have all these students. All these students are working in adult education settings, like adult learning centers, like community centers. They're working in these capacities. And so we can bring awareness to them about the situation in the world and hope that they, in their work, will make some difference. So I felt like, after this encounter and seeing this movie, I felt a little more at ease with being a professor. Big turning point in my career, because I thought, oh, I don't know if I want to do this or not. Okay. So then, let's see. So reflections from my journey so far, and then I had those other two parts. Reflections from my journey so far. Learn and study what you most enjoy, rather than what you think you will have the greatest payoff. Do what you love, and whatever else is important to you will follow. I really believe this. So when I have two children, and when they were in college, I said, major in what you want to major in. Whatever. Follow what you love. And my son majored in math and physics, and my daughter majored in economics. So they just did what they liked. And I think you should be open to and seek out opportunities that come your way. So, as I went to see this film because I heard it was good. Seek out opportunities that come your way. And it seems to me that its intersections and connections are what make your road. The intersections and these connections that you make in your road. Okay. Facilitating the journey. Here's some few quotes on mentoring. Sam Keen recalls what his mentor said. What do you want, Sam? What are your dreams? The first question an individual must ask is, what is my journey? Only then is it safe to ask the second question, who will go with me? What do you want to do? What do you want to learn? What do you want to be? And then who can assist you along the way? Who can assist you along the way? So, mentor. A guide, a mentor is a guide, a more experienced person assisting a less experienced person in that person's journey. And on being mentored, who, teacher, friend, stranger, nudged you along in your career? And on being a mentor, using your expertise to assist others to reach their goals. Now, this experience I had was a mentoring experience for me. But there were people in my career also who helped mentor me. One of my professors, when I was in a doctoral program, said to me, I wrote a paper for a class on philosophy of adult ed or something. And he said to me, this is a good paper. You should send it into the journal, the Adult Education Quarterly. And I said, well, yeah, but I'm just a graduate student. And he says, well, they don't know that. He said, send it in. It gets reviewed blindly. They don't know who sent it in. So he mentored me on how to get published. It was my first article. My first article, I sent it into the journal. And then early in my career, when I was in a department, the chair of the department, very famous person in our field, Phyllis Cunningham, chair of our department, she became my mentor. I watched how she did things. I watched how she was able to improve the program and everything. I watched, so there are different people in different stages of your career that do it. And you know, how do you find a mentor? What do you do for a mentor? Well, they appear in your life. They appear, but you can actively seek a mentor. And I have this interesting article, was just in our newspaper at home. It was in the New York Times. And it was an interview with the Deborah James, who is Secretary of the Air Force, very prominent woman. And she was asked, what is your advice on how to get a mentor? And she says, a mentor can be anybody in your environment, but it tends to be somebody older than you and somebody who's done things that you aspire to do. What I tell people, and I've done this myself, is that if you see somebody like this, just introduce yourself and ask them if they would be willing at some point to come sit down and have a cup of coffee with you and tell their story about what worked for them, what didn't work, and how their story unfolded in life and how they got to be where they are today. She says, I find that 95% of people will give you a half hour and a cup of coffee. So she just says, will you come have a cup of coffee with me and tell me about how you've gotten to be successful or whatever. So you can ask people. You can ask people to be your mentor, right? Okay, the second part here. So finding the path was the big part of this. But I also think serving and contributing is also a big part. Higher education, where we're all in right now, is a social institution. How do we link with the community and the world? Okay, now every university has a mission statement. And the University of Georgia's mission statement, part of it, is to teach, to serve, and to inquire into the nature of things. Okay? I first gave this talk at Northwest University in South Africa a couple months ago. And their mission statement says, I'm quoting right from their website, teaching, learning, and research harnesses diversity and pursues innovation to make a meaningful difference in South Africa and the world. Okay, and I looked up your mission statement, or part of it, one of the goals, and one of the goals for Chula University, and I'm quoting right from your website, promoting equal access to education for all, while also giving full support to the community. Right? So there isn't an institution of higher education anywhere in the world that doesn't have some mission related to linking with the community, serving the community. They're in the community. They're part of the community. They should consider this. And in higher education, there's lots of ways that this is done. Service learning, these are all ways in different universities that this serving your community, contributing is done. You probably have, do you have service learning programs here? I don't know, but that's a big thing now. Service learning, where you go out in the community and you help with a homeless shelter or orphanage or something, and you learn from working in the community. Extension and continuing education, university community engagement is called, and the research and dissemination of knowledge that helps the community is a big part of what higher education does. Okay. Now, many people have talked about this link between education and service and community. I'd like to give you some really, really good reflection on that. For example, Kofi Annan, who was UN Secretary General for a while, he says, education is, quite simply, peace building by another name. It is the most effective form of defense spending there is. And his quote down here is reminiscent of Solzhenitsyn's quote, suffering anywhere concerns people everywhere. Suffering anywhere concerns people everywhere. Okay, and another person who is very famous about this, Norman Borlaug and the Green Revolution. This guy is an agricultural specialist and is famous for developing a strain of wheat and then rice, which created a revolution in feeding the world. High-yield wheat products. He was in Mexico, Asia, Latin America, and there's a Rice Research Institute in the Philippines. He's all over the world. And he won the Nobel Peace Prize as father of the Green Revolution. He saved millions from starvation by his research and working in the field. And he's quoted as saying, I like this quote, he talks about some of these people who sit in offices or up in the ivory tower of the university, he says, they've never experienced the physical sensation of hunger. They do their criticizing from comfortable office suites in Washington or Brussels. If they live just 1 month amid the misery of the developing world as I have for 50 years, they'd be crying out for tractors and fertilizer and irrigation canals and be outraged that fashionable elites back home were trying to deny them these things. Very dedicated to improving the world. And he is, he was given an award for educating the next generation of students and leaders on the crucial importance of world hunger and food security. He won another award for that. So these are just some people that have given some thought to this, and I think it's important. And one of my favorites, of course, and I mentioned him before, is Paulo Freire in his Pedagogy of the Oppressed. And he talks about educators must reject the banking concept. They must abandon deposit making and replace it with posing problems for human beings in their relations in the world. And I also like this quote, washing one's hands of the conflict between the powerful and the powerless means to side with the powerful, not to be neutral. So what Freire's saying is, you need to get active and take a stand. Not just be neutral, that doesn't influence anything. And we also have, there are many people that have thought about this, and I think they're models. Bill Gates, you all know that, you all know him, right? Bill Gates and Microsoft, a billionaire. And he says, more than 30 years ago, Paul Allen and I started Microsoft because we wanted to be part of a movement to put a computer on every desk and in every home. 10 years ago, Melinda, that's his wife, and I started our foundation because we want to be part of a different movement, this time to help create a world where no one has to live on a dollar a day or die from a disease we know how to prevent. He has just come out, actually, there's just an article about this. He is predicting that in the not very distant future, we're going to have a pandemic of some disease that's going to affect the whole world, like the Spanish flu did back in the 1920s. Okay, part of this orientation is critical questioning, and you know, as we look about how we're contributing, we need to be asking, developing a critical eye So what about the social and economic inequities of our globalized world? If you're going to make a contribution, you need to be asking these questions. For example, who decides how resources are allocated? Who decides? Whose interests are being served? Who benefits? Who benefits? And in today's world of globalization, which is this rapid movement of people, goods and services, and ideas across national boundaries, but still, 72% live on less than $2 a day. 25.5% are illiterate. 70% of the absolute poor, the poorest people in the world, are women. And 75% of refugees are internally displaced and are women. So why is that? I mean, this is really a state of the world. It's got lots of problems here. And I think part of our development and everything is learning, figuring out where we can contribute. And I have posed these before, but I thought I'd read it again. We need to question, like, why is scholarship from the West privileged over knowledge from other parts of the world? Why are worldwide rates of illiteracy higher for women? And why is it that continuing professional education for doctors takes place on cruises or at resorts, but for teachers it takes place in the school after hours? Why is that? Okay, so these are questions we need to be asking. All right, making a contribution is the second part of this whole mentoring process. Figuring out how you, or getting guidance from a mentor, can think about what kind of contribution you can make in this world. And then the third part is this. Promoting lifelong learning. I think this is a part of the process. Real learning gets to the heart of what it is to be human. We become able to recreate ourselves. Survival or adaptive learning is important, but adaptive learning must be joined by generative learning, learning that enhances our capacity to create. This is Peter Senge from the fifth discipline. But there's some fairly famous people who have talked about the importance of learning who you wouldn't maybe think. Charles Darwin was famous for the origin of species. Huge, huge contribution to the world in the development of 18-something. And Charles Darwin says, for example, if the misery of the poor can be caused not by the laws of nature but by our institutions, great is our sin. And then this one I really like. In the long history of humankind, and animal kind too, those who learn to collaborate and improvise most effectively have prevailed. Collaborate. This is Charles Darwin talking back over a century ago. Those who learn to collaborate and improvise. And one of my favorites is Nelson Mandela, Robben Island. He talks about learning. Let me get my quote here. Nelson Mandela says about learning, he said, we started education on the island. Remember, he was in Robben Island for like 26 years as a prisoner. As a prisoner with cement bag paper. Those prisoners who built the harbor and the new prison stole empty cement bags for our education inside the cells. We used the cement bag paper to make books. He says, sometimes the criminals who worked for the warders smuggled in paper or lead pencils in exchange for tobacco. The warders would search our cells and take all our books or brown papers and burn them in a drum. So if you were teaching in one of the cells, I would write down the sentences on cement paper and bag paper and carry it with me. The next day, we would sit together crushing quarry stones. I would put my brown paper in front of you, and you would teach me. If the warders came near you, you would hide the papers under the stones. After years of complaining, they allowed us to buy stationery. Johnson Mambo would divide the stationery and would break a pencil into four pieces, one for each section. Slowly, they became less desperate, especially after Colonel Wilmsley arrived. He told them, "You cannot deal with these political prisoners by using force against them. They are cleverer than you. You must study." So the foundation of education on Robben Island was brown paper cement bags. You finished your standard 10 and then moved into C section. That became the University of Robben Island. So you see, you can't keep learning. You can't keep learning suppressed. It's not going to stay suppressed, even in very, very difficult situations. So now I'm hoping it'll work, I'd like to play for you a short video. It's about 4 minutes, about our world today, which underscores the importance for keeping learning. There's a little bit of sound right at the beginning, but then it's not, there's no talking, so you don't have to have it louder. Okay, let's hope it works.
There has never been a bigger force for change than technology. It changes absolutely everything about the way we live, the way we get around, the way we eat, even the way we talk to each other.
That's okay, it's almost finished. No, it's almost finished. Okay. You can find us online. Did you know? There's several different versions of it, but it's pretty astounding. So what impresses me in terms of continually learning from this this video is that there's 100 billion searches a month on Google. Somebody said, where did people find information before Google? 100 billion. That the top 10 jobs in 2010 did not exist in 2004. New jobs, new kinds of jobs being created all the time. And China soon to become the number one English-speaking nation, just by sheer numbers. And the half-life of knowledge. You know, if your college takes 4 years, if you take 4 years to get your degree in college, when time you graduate, what you learned in the first 2 years is outdated. That's a half-life of knowledge. So we need to keep learning. That's what we need to do. And finally, this was a surprise to me, 4,000 new books published every day. 4,000, that's amazing. Okay, so another part of our changing world, just wanted to point this out, that this is an interesting fact for me, since I'm not of your generation. 68% sleep with their mobile device next to the bed. 44% say it's the first and last thing they look at. That's from a study by Time, probably more now. Massive open online courses. You've heard of these, right, folks? They're huge. These things are huge. They have hundreds of thousands of people taking these courses. From hundreds of countries at the same time. And 15% of undergraduates are traditional, living on campus. 85% are adults, workers, parents, commuters. 60% of community college students are adults. This is in the U.S. I'm not sure what it is here. So, mentoring and higher education. These questions we have to be thinking about in our mentoring. How do we prepare our learners for the global world of the 21st century? With all of these changes coming down, right? Do we need to change the way we teach and learn? If so, how? And how can the university better serve the communities where it resides? How do we create and disseminate knowledge that makes a difference? Knowledge that makes a difference. That's what universities do. They create and disseminate knowledge in their research and publications. Okay? Continuing to learn is, to me, the key to this whole thing. So I would say think of learning as lifelong and life-wide. This is throughout our life, not just when you're in a school setting, and it has all parts of our life, from our family life, our community life, you know, our school life, all aspects of our life, life-wide, and cultivate self-directed autonomous learners. We have to teach or help people to become self-directed. Otherwise, what are you going to do when you finish with college? How are you going to keep up with your field? Don't forget, 2 years, you're already outdated. 2 years, what you learn is already outdated. So we have to cultivate self-directed learning. We could do that in our classes, actually, here. Foster learning that engages the mind, the body, and the spirit. Holistic. And I think we need to develop critical thinkers and reflective practitioners. That was the motto of our graduate program at the University of Georgia. We had about, at any one time, about 100 PhD students and another 50, 75 master students. And our goal was to develop reflective practitioners, ones who reflect upon what they're doing and ask about their practice. Okay? So, I want to conclude here. In conclusion, mentoring the next generation involves assisting in finding the path, making the road by walking. You just have to take advantage of opportunities and the people you come in contact with and help them form what you want to end up doing. And identify how to make a contribution. This is important. How do you make a contribution? How are you going to make a contribution to making this world a better place? Right? And finally, promoting lifelong learning. So I think mentoring involves these three things: finding the path, identifying how to make a contribution, and continually learning throughout our life. And that's where we're going to end up here. So thank you very much for letting me share my thoughts with you about mentoring and my own career, what I learned looking back at my long career in terms of what I experienced, and hopefully have in turn enabled many of my students to make contributions and be successes in their lives. So thank you very much. And I'm happy to take any questions anybody has or comments. So she's saying you cannot study what you want? Oh, yeah, right. Right. So how can we deal with high school students?
How we know
ourselves. Oh. I think it's a matter of time. That, you know, you don't wake up today and say, oh, now I know what I want to do and everything. It's a matter of time, and it's still taking advantage of opportunities to come your way. I know in, I don't know about Thailand, but in high schools in the United States, there are lots of clubs and activities that relate to the community. You can, you know, do things, and sometimes they have fundraisers, raise money for good causes like cancer, or the high school near where I live. One of the students in the high school had Lou Gehrig's disease, and the other students put together a big fair. Fundraising activities, and all the students came, and parents came, and neighborhood people came, and you know, they made contributions and played games, and they raised several thousands of dollars to help this student. And there are many opportunities like that in high schools in the States. I don't know about here. Are there? Yes, depends on the education system to facilitate that. Yes, I would agree with that, yeah. I think, you know, maybe you can contribute to that.
That's okay, to find an answer.
Yeah, okay, thank you. I think high school is something you survive. And then when you get to college, you have more chance to explore kinds of interests and develop, because you have to do certain things in high school and pass the tests and all that stuff. So, but there's still opportunities. Even in high school, there's service learning, where you a class in social studies or something has a service learning project in the community, where the students maybe volunteer at something and come back and then discuss their experience. So there's even that in like internships in high schools. Some other questions or comments?
Yes, Dr. Merriam, I like your question very much. You asked, do we need to change the way we learn and teach? And you asked for the board that, do we need to change the way we learn and teach? And I answered, yes, we should change the way we learn and teach. However, my question is that, I would like to know your experience or your country experience. How do we teach and how do we learn now before change to what?
The method
of teaching or the method of learning?
Yeah, how do we change the way we learn and teach?
Yes,
is your question?
You asked one of the suggestions.
We
need to change the way we learn and teach now and how we do it. That is the question you said.
Yes.
So
yes.
I answered you that. Yes, we should change the way we learn and teach. If I don't answer this, you will say, I am ignorant, which I am though. So I said, yes, we need to change the way we learn and teach. However, I like you to confirm my knowledge. What the method of learning and teaching that you experience now before we change to the future? Please.
So how do we change? What?
Yes, yes, but before we change, I would like to know the status of learning and teaching now.
Right.
The method of teaching and learning now before I will say, how do we do the next, how do we do after we change from here to there?
Well, you have to see how the change works and how you go with the times, what's happening in the world today. And, you know, to me, it's not very useful to memorize material in any subject. I think we need to interactively engage in the material and interact with activities. And you can use all sorts of things like, I don't know, case studies, simulations, and whatever, where you apply the knowledge in a certain field, not just memorize it. And as you apply it, as you engage with the material, you learn it. You learn it. You learn what it's all about. And I really like the thing called, we have something called reflective practicums. This is where students go do something in a field or something, come back and have a seminar about it and apply the theories to their situation. Reflect upon it in terms of theory and knowledge of that particular topic. In that
yes, so that's what we do now. We have done like this for decades or more.
Yeah.
Self-directed learning, student-centered, blah, blah, blah. And I still think right now we are still there. The same thing that you are talking about.
Yes.
If it changed, what kind of change should it be?
I don't know. I think we may have to get more into technology-enabled learning, because that's the way the world's going.
And what type of a method of teaching adopt in America now? The latest method of teaching adopt, please.
Well, in America, I think it depends on the subject, the field, and the social sciences. like sociology, English, history, the social sciences that are about people. There's much interactive kinds of activities, case studies, role plays, simulations, those kind of things. I can't speak to the sciences, chemistry, physics, I don't know.
Sharon, I wrote that method of teaching 50 years ago. I said 24 methods of teaching, case study, role playing, simulation, blah, blah, blah. I wrote 24 methods of teaching 40 years ago.
Wonderful.
I have not learned anything new, though. I would like to learn something new.
Please. I don't know what, beyond that, I don't know what they're using. And they're trying to make it more, I think the key is interactive. And there's many ways people are experimenting with making it interactive.
Cooperative, interactive, and correlative, something like that.
Right.
We are still there now.
And I think also group activities. You know, in the real world, it's very unusual to learn something totally on your own. Usually, you're with somebody else, or you're a member of an organization, or a family, or a union of somewhat. And there's learning that goes on in that community. So I think interactive in terms of involving other people in our learning. Group activities, I think, are an important mechanism for learning, because that's like real life, right? I mean, even when we talk about self-directed learning in adult education, that doesn't mean you go sit in a room all by yourself and direct your learning. That means you decide how you're going to learn. And most often, it's with other people or taking a class or whatever. But it's rarely that you're going to go sit by yourself and learn all by yourself. So I think the interaction and learning with other people and learning how to get along with other people and how to act very supportive, be a supportive group member rather than a disruptive group member.
I respect your work you are saying very much. I respect and I agree with you. But I have this difficulty. Students, do you have this difficulty? Sometimes we don't want to learn anything. We like to go to McDonald's, to go to Siam Square, Jamjuri Square, instead of reading. Next, how to teach higher education. My students have that problem, how to motivate and facilitate them to want to learn by themselves. Sometimes they don't feel like learning by themselves, they like to learn by experience, yes, but not very focused.
Yeah.
This is sometimes is a problem of some of the students.
Yes, yes.
We have that problem also.
Yes, we do. And sometimes I think that all the technology is not so good. Because, I was saying this to somebody else, sometimes my husband and I will go out to dinner, and we're sitting there and we're talking, and there'll be this younger couple in the table next to us, and he's on his thing, she's on her thing. They're not talking to each other, not even looking at each other. They're not talking to each other. I'm wondering if they're texting each other. I don't know, but we say, so why go out to dinner together? You're not communicating. You're not communicating. So sit home and do your texting or whatever. But sometimes I worry that young people can get too far into that, and. I asked my daughter, I have two granddaughters. They are 8 and 11 years old. And I asked my daughter, I said, how do you deal with this? You know, when my kids were growing up, the big question was, how much television do you let them watch? How much television? And I said to my daughter, how do you deal? They have iPads and they have TV and they have all this stuff, iPhones. And she said, well, we talk about
screen time. How much time your child can sit in front of a screen, TV screen, iPad screen, phone screen, any screen counts as screen time. And what they've done is, in their family, is my two granddaughters cannot look at any screens until they've done all their homework, and then they can if they want, and they cannot bring any device to the table when they're having dinner or lunch as a family. Because they don't want the kids sitting there, you know, they're not talking, they're not integrating. So they said, what she told me, what parents in the generation do is they try to control the amount of screen time. And also, it's important that young people get out and have activities with other young people, that they're not just on their phones or their iPads, you know, that they actually go play soccer or something, you know, they actually have some integration. So I think it's I think it can be worrisome. You can get lost in that technology. You just get lost. You're over there. You're not communicating with anybody. And they're doing some studies now that children are not reading nonverbal communication very well, like facial expressions and body awareness, because they're always looking at a screen. They're not looking at real people. So I think we need to have a balance. We need to have a balance of that as we grow up, get older. Anyway, so it's there are challenges. There's great, wonderful things with the technology, but there are some challenges I think we need to attend to. Yeah. So there was this.
I am interested in what you said. I would like to ask students in Thai. I think it's addictive. Okay. Addictive from, for example, myself, I don't pay attention to line, Facebook, thing like that. I said to my friends, no, I have no time. I am not interested in paying Facebook and line, something like that. But now I learn how to do it. I get addicted to it. I don't want to do other things. So I ask my student, is it a problem? I learn that Facebook and learn that I want to be This is the problem that I addicted in this world. I refuse it for a long time, but my friend said, you are ignorant. You are behind the hills, behind the mountain. You have to learn. When I learn, I cannot stop it. I play it every day, every time I can do. And the students say they have to find the problem. So how do we correct, how do we correct the problem, please? Anyway, in America.
No idea.
You are
yeah. It's something we have to be aware of and think about. You know, the benefits, but some of the issues with all of this technology and this instant communication and stuff. You know, and I can watch the news too much. You know, I go online and I look at all the news and stuff, and it's very depressing news that's going on now.
How about Donald Trump? Sharon, you said you listen to the news a lot, so I asked you, how about Donald Trump, your president?
Trump? Oh, yeah, that's the problem. I get so upset when I see the news about him. So I think, you know, it's good to not look at everything because you go crazy. You know, you go crazy. Yeah, so he's terrible. It's a mental case.
Has he finished making the sense? Has he finished making the sense between Mexico and your country? They want to make a wall from Mexico and your country. Has he finished making the wall or the fence separate from Mexico and your country? I use the word correct, fence or the wall. Trump said he want to build the wall
between U.S. and Mexico.
Has he finished that?
Well, he's told him to go start design the wall and start figuring out how to do it, but who knows? I don't know. Yeah, who knows? He has some serious mental health problems. Serious mental health problems. It's embarrassing when I travel around the world. I was in South Africa in November. I've been around different places, and I say, I want to pretend I'm from Canada. They have a great Prime Minister, Trudeau, so Canada, much better country. There's some funny things on the internet about immigrants from the U.S. going to Canada, and there's some funny articles about that, and they're saying, well, the Canadians are saying, or somebody wrote this, I don't know if we can handle all these U.S. citizens coming to Canada, because, you know, I don't know if we have that much free-range chicken and kale and, you know, all this stuff. And they, you know, it's just the same kind of thing they're saying about immigrants coming from Mexico, but they applied it to U.S. going to Canada. Very funny. Very funny. Okay, very good. Well, thank you again. I'll be around if anybody else talk about it. Thank you.